Well, Father God, we do come before you today in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we lift up our lives to you. And God, we just give you this time. And Lord, I just ask you to do whatever it is that you want to do in each and every one of us. Father, we're all here and gathered together today, and we're all experiencing different things in our life. We're going through different trials. We're going through different conflicts. We're going through different temptations. Some are more overbearing than others. But Lord, we all got circumstances in our life, Lord, that we just need to surrender lordship to you. So Father, I pray that you would meet each and every individual where they're at, God. And Lord, I pray that you would begin to work in their life, Lord. And Lord, you would bring about the lasting change that only you can provide for them. God, open up our minds and our hearts, God, to receive you right now. Lord, have your way in and through this message. Speak to us now. It's in Jesus' precious, holy, and amazing name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Several years ago, when Rhonda and I lived in the country, I was making my way home one wintry evening, and I'm telling you what, it was a really, really bad winter evening. It was actually, it was freezing rain. The blacktops were like just a skating rink. It was terribly slick. It was pitch black out. It was couldn't have been probably a worse night to try to drive home on. For those of you that don't know, where we lived, we actually lived about 20 miles south of Chillicothe, right out on Blacktop Z, and we lived down around the Bunch Hollow area, so we had about a 30-minute drive to get home on just good blacktops alone, much less driving when it's like a skating rink. It's probably one of those things that I probably should have stayed in town and not went, but I decided I was going to go anyway. So if you're familiar with Blacktop Z, then you know after you pass C Blacktop that takes you into Dawn, then you're going to go straight for a little while, and then there's going to be this really giant hill that you got to climb up, and it's known as McCracken's Knob, because McCracken lives right there at the top of that, and it's a really, really steep, steep hill, and at the top of that, it kind of levels out, and then you go around an S-curve. But I knew that hill was going to give me problems. I knew that that was going to be the one that I really needed to watch out for, as slick as the roads were. So as I was heading home, I get to that hill, and I've got to decide what to do, because you know, in ice, you got to go pretty slow, but to get up that hill, I knew I was going to have to pick up some momentum and start going fast as I get into that hill and try to keep it in between the ditches, because there's big ditches on each side that I didn't want to end up in. So I'm hitting that hill, and I'm going with what I was hoping to have enough momentum to get to the top, and I'm telling you what, I was white-knuckled all the way. I was holding on to that steering wheel for dear life. I was praying like none before. I was rolling with sweat, you know, hoping to make it up that hill, and as it just continued to sleet and that road was so slick, I get just about to the top of the hill. I can see where it all levels out. I'm getting excited because I'm just about there, and I get closer, and as I get closer to the top of the hill, I start slowing down, and I start slowing down, and I start slowing down until, I mean, I can just see it. It's right there. I just need to go a little bit more. And I finally just come to a complete stop. And then my tires start spinning. And I start, instead of going forward, now I'm starting to go backwards on that hill at the top of the hill. And I thought, oh my gracious. I had about 1,000 things that started going through my mind right then. I started thinking, how stupid am I to have tried this? I should have stayed in town. I shouldn't have done this. I hope my life insurance is paid up, because this is not going to be very pretty. And I just started praying, God, you're going to have to do something right here. And I did the smartest thing that I could have ever done that night. I surrendered control to God. You know, everything in me wanted to do something. Everything in me wanted to try to steer, do something. I wanted to slam on the brakes, put the gas, do anything. I just needed to do something. But instead, you remember the Carrie Underwood song, or Underwood song, Jesus Take the Wheel? That became my life that night. I was basically saying, God, I can't do this. It's going to have to be you to keep me from going off into the ditch. So I basically just kind of relaxed my hands. I didn't do anything. And I just said, God, you got this. And as I was there, I started going backwards. And as I was going backwards, the nose of my car started going sideways. And here I'm going down Z Blacktop, down that hill sideways now. And the nose just keeps on turning until I do a complete 180. And I just ride right on down the hill and ride on out. I thought, praise Jesus. That he took over that night and got me down the end of the hill. You know, as I look back at that day, it's a very memorable day. You know, it's one of those things that it just reminds me just like it was yesterday. I have that memory. I know exactly how I was feeling on the inside, and I know what Jesus did, and I was so excited about that. But as I look at that day, I realize that the hardest thing that I had to do that day was to let go. That's hard because you want to stay in control. Isn't that right? So for me to let go, it was the hardest thing that I had to do that day, but it was the best thing that I could have ever done, because had I not let go, I was probably going to end up in the ditch if I had tried to do things my way. You know, as I think about that and as I think about that incident, I kind of put it into the Christian's perspective and how we do life. And you know, I think a lot of Christians sometimes, and even including myself, we have a problem sometimes with letting go, don't we? Anybody struggle with that? We have a problem with letting go. We have a problem with just kind of surrendering everything and letting God have everything in our life. You know, we just kind of hold on to that steering wheel in life, don't we? We kind of white knuckle it all the way. We want our will to be done. We want to be in control. We want to be able to turn right when we want or left when we want. We want to be able to do whatever it is that we want to do. And some of us are a little stubborn, isn't that right? We're a little stubborn and we want to do things my way. Nobody's going to tell us what we can do and what we can't do. Can anybody relate to that? Do I have any stubborn people in the house today? I would say we all are stubborn to a certain extent. Can I tell you guys, it's this line of thinking. It's that stubborn, not wanting to yield control. It's that type of thinking that causes us to make poor choices. It causes us to make poor choices and it causes us to end up in the ditch with our marriages. Isn't that right? Because we want to do things our way. It doesn't matter what Rhonda wants. What matters is what makes me feel good and what I want. And what matters to her is what she wants. So we end up butting heads and it causes us to get into the ditch because we're stubborn and we want to control. But it also causes us to get in the ditch with our families. It causes us to get in the ditch with our careers. It causes us to get in the ditch with our relationships. It also causes us to struggle with addiction problems. We resort to alcohol and drugs, gambling, pornography. We also causes us to have anger problems and gossip problems and gluttony problems and theft problems and murder problems and greed problems and jealousy problems. Listen, guys, the list goes on and on if I didn't name your sin, right? But it boils down to this. It boils down to this. It's all a sin problem. Isn't that right? If we just got honest, control, selfish, holding on to life, it's absolutely a sin problem. You see, it happened way back in the Garden of Eden whenever God created Adam and Eve. You know what went wrong in that? God gave us free choice. He gave us free choice. And what does our selfish desire end up wanting? It wants to do the things our way. And we want to be in control. And we want to do things our way. And we refuse to surrender to God. You know, we come to God, right? We end up making Him part of our life. But this is what we end up doing. And I find so often, we give God just a little bit, don't we? Or we give Him what we want to give Him. I say, God, you can have this, you can have that, and you can have this. But don't ask for this. Or don't ask for that because it's going to challenge me a little bit more. And I kind of like that area in my life right now. So I'm going to hold on to that just a little bit longer. And the problem is this is not the way Christianity should look. Christianity is about letting go and letting God and surrendering everything to Him and giving Him every single area of our life. And guys, can I tell you, when we do that, when we give God control, then He will absolutely do a 180 in your life and He will turn you and put you in the opposite direction of where you're going. Can anybody testify to that and believe that? Amen. So why don't we do that more often? Why do we do that just every once in a while with God? God wants complete control of everything. You know, last week we started this new sermon series called Jesus Is. And in this series, each week we're going to take another look at another description of who Jesus is in our life and for the life of a believer. Last week, Pastor Kevin shared how Jesus is our Savior, needs to be our Savior. And my question is, have you accepted Him as your personal Lord and Savior? Is Jesus your Savior? Do you know that you know that you know where you're going to spend eternity if you would take your last breath? Guys, I'm telling you, if you can't, then you need to nail that down. You need to nail it down before you leave, because we're not guaranteed that we even make it through this afternoon, will we? We have no idea. So you need to nail that down. Today we're focusing on how, when you accept Jesus into your life, can I tell you, you're not just making Him your Savior, you're also making Him your Lord. You're making Him the Lord of your life. So what does that mean? What's the difference? What does it mean? It means you're no longer in control. It means you're no longer in control. When you get saved, when you give your life to Jesus, He becomes your Savior and your Lord. Can I tell you, your life doesn't have room for two lords? But that's what we do, isn't it? We want to remain Lord of our own life. We want Jesus just a little bit here, but we don't want to surrender to Him. And guys, when he's the Lord of your life, you're no longer in control. You yield everything to him. He calls the shots. When you need direction, he leads you. When you're faced with temptation, he empowers you to overcome it. When you're faced with overwhelming trials, he gives you the strength to get through it. Listen, guys, when Jesus is the Lord of your life, you trust him in every single situation you find yourself in. You just trust him. Open up your Bibles to Mark. We're going to be in Mark 14 today, verses 32 through 42. And we're going to discover from the example that Jesus gives us how we can make him Lord of our life. Now, as you're flipping there, I just want to kind of set the scene a little bit so you understand as we're moving into this what's taking place here. It was Passover week, and it was the night that Jesus and his disciples had just finished taking the Lord's Supper, the very thing that we just celebrated. And they took the Last Supper together, and it was just a few hours before Jesus would later be stand in trial and be crucified. And they left the upper room and they departed the city. They made their way from Jerusalem to somewhere at the foot of the Mount of Olives. And there was a grove of olive trees called Gethsemane. Guys, Luke 22 and 39, it indicates that Jesus had visited this place often. This was a place that when Jesus was in town, he would go there. He would go there often. Gethsemane was a place of refuge for the Lord. It was a place that he could go and find solitude from the crowds gathering around in the ministry that occupied his life. It was a place where he could go and find a private moment to spend with the Father. It was his sanctuary from the attacks of the enemies. It was a place that he could find refreshment from the long day of ministry. In other words, the Garden of Gethsemane was a special place to Jesus where he went and did business with the Father. Let me ask you, do you have a special place like that in your life? Do you have a place where you go to do business with God the Father? That, man, this is just my special place that I go and I pray and I spend time with him and I feel closely connected with him. Can I tell you, my screened-in porch is that place. I love sitting out on my screened-in porch at 4:30, 5, 5:30 in the morning. I love sitting there as the sun coming up and drinking coffee and reading Bible and spending time with the Lord. I like it better now that it's starting to warm up a little bit better. It makes it a lot more tolerable being out there. But do you have that special place? The Lord loved to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. You know, the name Gethsemane here, the origin of this word means olive press. See, Gethsemane was filled full of olive trees, and it produced fruit, and they would take the olives where they would be collected, and they would be placed in a press, and the precious olive oil was extracted from the olives under intense pressure. See, this night in the garden, the Lord Jesus, he entered into the olive press, and under intense pressure, the sweet oil of grace and the submission to the Father's will would be extracted from Jesus' life. So follow along with me as I read Mark 14, 32 through 42, and let's discover what took place in the garden that night. It says, they went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and he prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Then he returned to his disciples and he found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more, he went away and he prayed the same thing. And when he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy and they did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. You know, I find it interesting that the struggle that took place in the Garden of Gethsemane, it graphically contrasts the struggle that took place in the Garden of Eden some several thousand years earlier. See, in the Garden of Eden, the first Adam was faced with the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and he surrendered to the plot of Satan. And in the garden, the last Adam, who was Jesus, was faced with the tree of Calvary, and he yielded to the plan of God. The first man asserted his own will to the ruin of human race, and Jesus abandoned his own will for the redemption of human race. There's quite a difference in the outcome of the two gardens, wasn't it? One surrendered to the plot of Satan, and one surrendered to the will of God and got completely different results. Guys, can I tell you that the same is true with you? The same is true with me. If we surrender to the schemes of the devil, if we surrender to his plans, we're going to get a completely different outcome than if we would just surrender to the lordship of Jesus Christ and the plans that he has for our life. So as we look and think about what's taking place in the garden, you know, I really want us to paint a picture of what Jesus was experiencing in that garden. I want to take us to that night and understand how what he was going through and what he was experiencing. And my plan is, and what I'm praying and believing for, is that we look and see what he has done for me and what he's done for you, that we would love him that much more. You know, when somebody does things for you, don't you love them that much more? And I want you to understand the extent of that night and what Jesus did. And I hope that you'll love him more, but I also desire and pray and believe that you'll learn to imitate him, because when, not if, but when we're faced with trial and temptation and conflict, that we'll come through it with victory. Don't you want to come through things with victory instead of falling to it every single time? Don't you want to experience some victory in your life? So let's look at our outline here. Let's look at a couple things. First of all, I want us to understand that number one, Jesus encountered trouble. Jesus encountered trouble. Let me ask you, have you ever encountered trouble in your life that caused you to be a little overwhelmed? Anybody? Anybody ever experienced trouble? Caused some overwhelming feelings, some things you're going through? My guess is, yeah, my guess we all have. And you know what? Jesus experienced trouble as well too, so he can relate. Listen to what verse 33 says. We read that he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. Okay, deeply distressed and troubled. So what does that mean? Let's look at these words just a little closer so we can understand the intensity of this. You know, these words, the word translated trouble actually means to be amazed or alarmed or to be struck with terror. That's what it means. Jesus was struck with terror for the events that was getting ready to come up, and he was carrying this around. And the word deeply distressed here means to be in anxiety, distressed, uncomfortable, or troubled. And then in the Gospel of Luke, he uses the word agony to describe what Jesus was experiencing here. This word agony is a Greek word that's used to describe the intense struggle or the conflict that's found in the Greek athletic games. And so when we move right to verse 34, we even see Jesus in his own words. Jesus even tells us what he's feeling right now in that night in the garden. And this is what Jesus says. He says, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." That's what Jesus said. That's his word. He says, "My soul is overwhelmed to the point of death." Isn't that crazy to think that Jesus was feeling so overwhelmed that he felt like he was dying? That must be some pretty crazy stuff that he was going through. And then according to Luke, as he prayed, he did so with such intensity that the capillaries in his forehead began to burst and the sweat and blood mingled together and dropped to the ground. That's intense, isn't it? That's pretty overwhelming. When's the last time you prayed with such intensity that your sweat turned to blood? That ever happened to anybody before? I would say Jesus was experiencing some overwhelming times right here. You see, even though Jesus was fully God, he knew he came to die, but he was still very much a man. And he knew what laid before him in the final hours that drew near. In fact, Jesus compares the trouble that he's about to encounter to drinking a cup. So let's look in this cup right now so we can understand what caused much of his distress and sorrow and alarm. First of all, I would have to say that the obvious is probably true. Jesus was probably anticipation of the physical pain, because he was human, right? Even though Jesus was fully God in the flesh, his body was still just as human as yours and mine. It was still just as human. He experienced and felt every single thing that we went through. Let me ask you some questions. Does your body experience weariness? So did Jesus's. Did your body experience hunger? Anybody hungry right now? It experiences that, right? So did Jesus. Does your body experience being sleepy and tired? So did Jesus's. Does your body experience pain? So did Jesus's. He experienced everything that night and felt every single bit of it. You know, it's impossible for us to know how Jesus was feeling, but my guess is to some degree in his human nature, he must have been troubled over the physical suffering and the death that he was about ready to encounter. You know, I guarantee you, there's not a single person in this room that would be excited and look forward to the amount of bloodshed that Jesus was getting ready to encounter. Would you be excited about that? All the bloodshed that he went through, would you be excited about getting ready to encounter that? And in fact, I'd probably have to say, some of you probably begin to hyperventilate when you just think about your finger getting pricked. Isn't that right? The thought of needle or the thought of blood is something that you don't look forward to. You know, I know it's nothing that my wife looks forward to. She's overwhelmed every time she has to think about getting an IV or a needle or anything like that. And one of the biggest reasons that she gets overwhelmed is she's got really, really bad veins. So every single time they have a problem trying to get it into her veins, and they always struggle with that. So they always poke around and dig around before they can finally find something. And she's sweating usually and about to pass out. So it's nothing that she looks forward to. So then one night, probably, I don't know, 10 years ago, I was really surprised when my wife tells me, "I think I'm going to give blood this year." Really? Because that, I knew there's going to be the sacrifice, that because she's not, I mean, she doesn't like that because she knows it's going to be a struggle. And it come true this time as well. So we go to the Tyne Avalon school when they're doing a blood drive, and she goes and sets down. It's her turn, and she's all worried. She's got anxiety. She's overwhelmed because she knows this is going to happen. And they dug around on her arm for I don't know how long, and they never did find a vein in that arm. So then they switch over to her other arm, and they dug around in that one, all while she's turned like this and about to pass out and sweating and sitting there. I felt so sorry for her, but I couldn't do anything for her. And then they finally found her vein. Finally found it, put it in there, put the bag up there, and she starts giving blood. And then all of a sudden, it stops. It just stops. And the lady said, "Uh-oh." And Rhonda's like, "What do you mean, uh-oh?" And they're like, "Your veins stopped giving blood." And Rhonda goes, "What do you mean it stopped giving blood?" And she said, "It just did. It stopped giving blood." And so she said, "Well, what does that mean now?" And she said, "Well, it means that it's over. We can't take any more. And unfortunately, we didn't get enough blood in here to do any good, so the blood's got to be thrown away. We can't even use it." So Rhonda's like, can't even use it. So needless to say, Rhonda's blood has never saved anybody's life. And she's never done it again. She's never done it again since then. You know, there's no doubt in my mind, in Jesus' human nature, he wasn't looking forward to the physical pain that he was getting ready to endure, the physical pain that he was going to encounter as he shed his own blood to save mankind. But secondly, I'm sure that there was an anticipation of the emotional pain that he was going to go through. You know, Jesus knew the prophecy of Isaiah 53 was about to be fulfilled, which says he was despised and rejected by men. You see, Jesus could look at the fast approaching hours and he could see his traitor Judas coming. How would you like that? One of your friends that walked with you for the last 3.5 years, you knew he was going to betray you. And Jesus could look into that. He could see the rejection. He could see the traitor coming. He also knew that his disciples were all going to ditch him, that they were all going to flee. He also knew that he was going to be rejected by his own people. He also knew that he would face the shame of the mock trial. He also knew that he'd be made fun of as they took the crown of thorns and they shoved it down on his head. He also knew that he was going to experience shame as they stripped him of his clothes. He also knew that he was going to be made a spectacle of as they lifted him up high on the cross for all to see. He knew that he would suffer complete and utter loneliness. And we think we got it bad sometimes. See, Jesus could see ahead. He could understand what was going on. And he was overwhelmed by this. He was overwhelmed by the anticipation of physical and emotional pain. But thirdly, and what I believe he was dreading the most, was the anticipation of the spiritual pain that he was about to encounter. You see, what awaited for Jesus wasn't just death. It was death for the payment of the world's sins. That's what awaited for him. And Jesus was overwhelmed because he could see the spiritual agony in that cup. Think about it right now. The holy, sinless Son of God. Never messed up. Never did a single thing wrong. And he was getting ready to carry the full weight, to bear the full weight of the world's sins on his shoulders. And sometimes we feel like we're carrying around the weight of the world, right? Have you ever been there before? Can I tell you, we didn't have nothing compared to what Jesus was experiencing that night. He was getting ready to have your sin and my sin all on his shoulders. Isaiah 53 says this, "The Lord would lay on him the iniquity of us all." You know, Jesus saw the cross as an altar. He saw the cross as an altar. He saw himself as the sacrifice for our sins. He would bear our penalty for us. He would bear our guilt and our death. He would experience the holy wrath of God against sin. Can I tell you, that's the wrath that was meant for us? That was the wrath that we deserve, not him. And he was going to experience that and not just bear our sins. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that he would be made sin for us. He would be made sin for us. So he didn't just bear it. He became sin for us. That means when they nailed him to the cross, he would become a murderer. He would become a thief. He would become a liar. He would become an adulterer. He would become a glutton and much, much more in the eyes of God as he bore our sins. And Jesus knew that for the first time ever, God the Father was going to turn his back on him because of the sin on his shoulders that he was carrying. How that must have overwhelmed Jesus, don't you think? To carry your sin and mine and know that God the Father was going to turn his back on him. You know, for a believer, just the thought of what our Lord and Savior agonized over in the Garden of Gethsemane that night should cause us to not take our sins lightly. Don't you think? Think about it. 2,000 years ago, what he went through. And here we can just nonchalantly sin. We can just do whatever it is in our life and not even have a problem with it. Just do whatever makes you feel good. Do whatever makes you happy. Just go through it, not even thinking about the struggles and what Jesus went through. You know, there was a day in my life that I claimed Jesus as my Savior. I claimed him as my Savior, but I didn't treat him as my Lord. And I took sin very, very lightly, and it didn't bother me. I had no conviction. It didn't bother me at all. You know what my excuse was? I said, oh, God loves me, and he'll forgive me. He'll forgive me. It'll be fine. It didn't bother me at all. Listen, friend, can I tell you, I've come to the realization that that's not salvation. That's not salvation. What I had before was really just a poor attempt at fire insurance. I just didn't want to go to hell. It was a poor attempt at fire insurance. He was not the Lord of my life. That wasn't salvation. 17 years ago, he truly became my Lord and Savior. He truly became my Lord and my Savior, and everything in my life changed. Everything. It doesn't mean that I stand up here sinless and perfect. That's not it at all. That's why he had to die for us. But can I tell you, when I sin, now I'm convicted of it. I wasn't convicted before 17 years ago. The only thing I didn't want to do is get caught. Right? But now I'm convicted of my sin, and I want to get things right. I want to live for him. I want him to be glorified. That's the difference now. And I tell you what, the things that I used to do and the things that I do now when I mess up, it breaks my heart. And it breaks my heart to think that the trouble that Jesus experienced in the garden that night, he was overwhelmed with my sin. Because my sin put him through it. It was my anger that he was dealing with. It was my addiction. It was my lust. It was my pride. It was my jealousy. It was my envy. It was my sin that put him there and caused so much agony in the garden that night. Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, he took my place so I didn't have to. And he took your place too. And can I tell you right now, friend? If you call yourself a Christian and that doesn't bother you at all, sin doesn't bother you, then my encouragement to you is re-examine your life. Re-examine your salvation. Did you accept Jesus as your Savior for fire insurance? Or did you make him Lord and Savior of life? Because I believe salvation proclaims both. He is my Lord and he's my Savior. If we're ever going to be the Christian that gives him complete control of our lives by following his example, then we first must understand that the Son of God encountered troubles. Then guess what? We're probably going to too, right? If he encountered troubles, we're going to as well. And whether the troubles that we encounter is from trials, temptations, or conflict, the answer is the same. And we find that answer in number two. Jesus exercised prayer. Jesus exercised prayer in the garden that night. Here he is. He's faced with the greatest difficulty of his life for the reasons we just talked about. But you know where I also believe he was experiencing some pressure from? From Satan. Because I don't believe Satan wanted him to go to the cross. Satan didn't want this to happen. He didn't want this to go. You know, Satan had already tempted him in the wilderness three years earlier, right? Wanted him to forego the cross and the plans. And I can just imagine that night that in the garden, while he's overwhelmed, while he has everything going on, I can just imagine Satan whispering in his ear, "Why would you do this, Jesus? Peter, James, and John, the ones that you told them to stay awake, they're all going to flee. They're all going to leave. Judas is going to betray you. All your disciples, you're going to be rejected. You're going to be rejected by your people. Why would you do this? There's got to be another way. You can make the stones cry out and follow you. Why do you got to go to the cross? Why are you going to put your mother through this, right? The agony of seeing her son crucified. Jesus, you just need to give it up and go another way." You see, Satan didn't want the cross to happen because he knew the cross was going to change everything. He knew the cross was going to change everything. He knew that that Calvary was the ultimate goal of the Father. He knew that Jesus would defeat sin and Satan. And Satan's a sneaky snake, isn't he? He's a sneaky snake, and he's going to destroy our lives and the progress of Christianity. And he's going to do anything in the world to make that happen. In fact, the Bible says that he's a roaring lion seeking whom he will devour. And he was at work in the garden 2,000 years ago. And that's why Jesus told the disciples to what? Watch and pray. Watch and pray so you don't fall into temptation. He said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Jesus knew the temptations were strong, and we needed to be ready, because we're in enemy territory, guys, and we need to be alert because temptation's real. And we're just as in much danger as the disciples falling away, right? We're not greater than they are. They didn't listen to Jesus, and we will too fall away if we don't listen and learn from his words as well. So Jesus says to watch and pray. So let's quickly look at a few characteristics of the prayer that Jesus prayed. First and foremost, it was a humble prayer. You know, the Bible doesn't say that Jesus kneeled or stood. The Bible says in verse 39 that he fell to the ground. Jesus fell to the ground. Matthew 26, 39 says that he fell on his face. What an amazing thought to think that the eternal Son of God fell on his face to pour out his prayers to God the Father. When's the last time you humbled yourself in a way that you fell on your face before God and just poured your heart out to him? When's the last time? James 4, 6 says, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Jesus' prayer was humble, but secondly, it was also an intimate prayer. In verse 36, Mark says that Jesus addressed God as Abba Father. You see, Abba was the Aramaic term that was equivalent to our word daddy. That's what that means. It's the same as a word for daddy. It was an intense intimacy word. It was very intimate, and in fact, it was a word that people in the Jewish household would use, but they would use it regarding their earthly fathers. There's not a single one of them that would refer to God, the Father, as daddy. They didn't feel that close. They didn't do that. They didn't have that intimacy. But here we are. We see Jesus, and he enjoys the intimacy with his Father, and he felt comfortable enough to call him Daddy as he prayed. You know, as I was thinking about this, you know, in December, maybe some of you don't know, but we adopted 3 children. And before we adopted those children called us by our names. But after we adopted those children, the children now call us Dad. They call us Dad. And now my 4-year-old little girl, Annie, she calls me Daddy. She calls me Daddy. And man, every time she calls me Daddy, it just absolutely melts my heart. Melts my heart. I'm so thankful that this little 4-year-old girl that didn't even know me last year at this time, didn't even know me, feels close enough and intimate enough with me to call me her Daddy. Let me ask you, do you feel close enough and intimate with Jesus to call him Abba Father or Daddy? If not, you should, because the Apostle Paul says in Romans 8:15, the spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the spirit you receive brought you about your adoption to sonship, and by him we can cry, Abba Father, Abba Father. Thirdly, it was a persistent prayer. You know, we see in this passage that Jesus prayed 3 times using the same words. Now, I'm not sure why he prayed 3 times and why he stayed persistent, but you know what? Maybe he didn't feel like he had complete victory over the troubles that he was facing, so he just kept praying. He kept praying through it. You know, guys, I believe that if you want Jesus to be Lord of your life, then when you're dealing with trials, you need to persistently pray your way through it. Do you know how many times I see people throw in the towel when they're going through those trials? Don't stop. Don't throw in the towel. Keep praying your way through it. When you're faced with overwhelming temptations, don't just pray once. You pray until you have victory, right? You keep praying. You keep praying your way through it. When you have conflicts, persistently pray until you're able to get it right. Don't let up. Stay at it, and I promise you, he'll see you through it. Jesus prayed humbly. He prayed intimately. He prayed persistently. And lastly, it was an obedient prayer. It was an obedient prayer. Guys, now I want you to listen up to me real, real good, because this is where I believe the rubber meets the road when it comes to our walk with God and him being Lord of our life. Are you willing to accept what God has in store for your life, even if it's not what you're praying for? Because that's where true lordship comes. When you're willing to accept whatever he has for your life, even if it's not what you want, even if it goes contrary to your plans. See, Jesus was troubled, and he prayed, Abba, Father, Daddy, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Again, Jesus knew what was coming. He wasn't looking forward to it, but in verse 36, he tells that he's willing to do whatever the Father wants. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Jesus was in perfect submission to God's plan because he knew his plan was perfect. You see, that's what it looks like for us when Jesus is the Lord of our lives. It's okay to make a request as long as we understand that even if Jesus doesn't answer it the way that we wanted to, I'm still going to submit to his plans. I'm still going to give him glory. I'm still going to let him walk me through it, even if it doesn't look like what I want. You know, I heard a preacher one time make this statement. He said, if you pray, nevertheless, your will be done. It's actually a cop-out for Christians to exercise their faith. Guys, I think that is absolutely poor theology. I think that's poor theology. I think that's arrogant, prideful, and selfish. And in fact, it's all the characteristics of Satan's rebellion against God. Listen, friend, if it's not God's plan for my life, I don't want it. I don't want it. And if it is God's plan for my life, even if I really don't want it, I'll still gladly go through it and try to give him the glory all the way through it and trust him even in the process. So what about you? Are you willing to pray like Jesus, not my will, but yours be done? Are you willing to, when you're faced with temptations, when you're feeling overbearing, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. When you're faced with trials and storms and struggles, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. When you're faced with conflict, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. Listen, guys, you will never truly experience Jesus as Lord until we abandon our own plans. Until we abandon our own plans, until we trust God with his, even if it doesn't make sense. You know, when it doesn't make sense, I have to hold on to Romans 12, 22, that says God's will is good and acceptable and perfect. I just have to understand and trust him with that he knows the plans that are best for me. You know, as I think about what Jesus went through, I think about all of his suffering that he experienced so he could save us from sins. If I look at it that way, and if I understand that I'm suffering over something that's beyond my control, that I can't do anything about it, then maybe I just got to believe that this is God's acceptable and perfect plan, and the purpose is for somebody else to get saved because of the way that I'm walking through it. You know, if Jesus suffers so people can get saved, so the world can be saved, then maybe we might have to suffer a little bit, and that's going to be okay, isn't it? Yeah. We're not going to live in a hunky-dory world where everything's right. He just wants us to be Lord of our life, and we trust him through it all. I would hate to miss out on what God has in store for my life. Jesus encountered trouble. Jesus exercised prayer. And finally, number three, and we're getting close to an end here. Because of handling trouble the right way through prayer, Jesus experienced victory. You know, that night in the garden, a terrible battle took place. But in that battle, Jesus won. The conflict ended in complete victory. By the time that Jesus was done praying, he had a completely different change of mind. He was completely different by the time he was done than what he was going into this. He was no longer distressed. He was no longer in anguish. He was no longer overwhelmed. You can see the change in verses 41 through 42. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough." He said, "The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." You know, when Gracie, sitting here on the front row, when she was 15 years old and she got her permit, I remember sitting in the car that day in the passenger side as she got behind the steering wheel and she put her hands on the steering wheel and she looked over at me and she said, "Let's do this thing." I got real nervous real quick about what was getting ready to happen. But you know what? In the garden that night, there was a victory won. Jesus had prayed his way to peace and calmness, and he wakes the disciples up in a very humble and confident way, and he says, "You know what? It's time. Let's do this thing." He was ready to walk out what God called him to do and what he was supposed to do. And you know what? From that point on, he was calm. The events that unfolded, Jesus bravely awaits Judas and his band of soldiers. He allows himself to be bound by them. He rebukes Peter for trying to resist him with a sword. He faces a mock trial. He calmly stands before Pilate. He doesn't try to defend himself against the false charges. Not once did the terrible sins of the people cause him to respond in a like manner. And in fact, from the cross, he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." Guys, that's victory right there, isn't it? That's victory as they went on. See, Jesus did not go in the garden to hide from the cross. He went into the garden to get strength to face the cross for you and for me. You see, Jesus experienced victory because he had prayed and submitted his will to the Father's, unlike the disciples. See, the disciples who fell asleep, they also fell apart. They fell apart, they scattered, they were fearful, they were confused, and then Peter openly denied him as Lord. I'm going to ask the praise team to come on up. So let me ask you, is Jesus your Lord? Is Jesus your Lord? Is he calling the shots in your life? Is he calling every area in your life the shots? Have you trusted him in every area? Listen, guys, troubles are real, aren't they? Troubles are real. And as we go through this life, we're going to go through all kinds of trouble. We're going to go through troubles. We're going to encounter conflict. And I tell you what, if Jesus isn't your Lord, you're going to fall apart. We're going to encounter temptations And can I tell you, if Jesus isn't your Lord, you're going to fall apart. We're going to encounter troubles in our life and through trials that we go through. And if Jesus isn't your Lord, you're going to fall apart. You know, we have several people right now at Life Point Church, and they're going through some troubles. Man, they're going through some trials, and they're going through some storms in all different kinds of ways. We got a handful of people right now going through trials in the form of cancer. Ugh, don't you hate that word? They're going through it, and man, I tell you what, they're walking through it. And can I tell you, these people that are going through it, they have become some of my heroes in the faith. You want to know why they're some of my heroes in the faith? It's because of the way they're walking through it. They're walking through it, and they're trusting God in the midst of it. They're trusting God even when it doesn't make sense. They're trusting God even when He hasn't answered what they want to happen as far as taking it away. And they're keeping their eyes on God. They're keeping it on the cross. I would love to share with you all the people's names, but I haven't asked them for permission, so I probably shouldn't. But I am going to share with you one person that gave me the right to go ahead and talk about it today. And this person, you probably see him every single week and you have no idea what he's going through. You want to know why you don't know? Is because he's praising God all the way through it. Because he's walking through it in victory. 2 months ago, I got a text from him and he said, "Hey, Brent, could you stop by my office today?" He said, "I got to talk to you." I said, "I'll be there in a little bit." And so there I do. I pull up to the parking lot at Community Press where Scott Rule owns. And I walk back to Scott's office and I could tell this was going to be a serious conversation. I sat down and with his eyes watery, you know, he looks at me and he says, "Well, I might have cancer." And man, I tell you what, I was overwhelmed. My eyes are all watering up. And he said, "Brent," he said, "it's going to be okay." He said, "It's going to be okay." He said, "You know, Lisa and I," he said, "we're praying and believing that it's not cancer. We're waiting for the test results to get back. But," he said, "you know what?" He said, "if it is cancer, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay because God's got this. And we're going to trust Him, and we're going to trust Him every single step of the way. I'm not going to stop praising Him. I'm not going to stop loving Him. I'm not going to stop trusting Him. I'm going to keep on keeping on. And I just believe that God's got this." Well, since that time, it's been confirmed he's got cancer. And they installed a port in him last week, and he starts chemotherapy tomorrow morning. And in the midst of all of this, he finds out, this is his father-in-law right here, he finds out that his mother-in-law gets diagnosed with cancer as well. At the same time, that's a lot on your plate all at once, isn't it? You know what? As I look at their life, they're all four walking through this together. And they're all doing the same thing. They are all believing that God is a miracle working God, but they are also trusting God's plan. No matter what that looks like, they're trusting Him. And they're walking through this and they're giving Him praise all the way through it. As are the rest of the ones that I didn't mention. They're walking through it, and that's why they're my heroes in the faith right now, is because I don't know what I would respond to if I hear those words. I hope I would walk through it like they are, but you know what? They're right in the midst of it right now, and this is where the rubber meets the road, and they're walking it out, and they're trusting Him all the way through it. You know how come they're able to do that? It's because Jesus Christ isn't just their Savior. Jesus Christ is the Lord of their life. The Lord of their life, and they're trusting His perfect, an acceptable and perfect plan, and they're walking this out together. So with that in mind, I want us to stand and rise at our feet as we close. I want you all to bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment. And I want to extend this invitation to you. Is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? There's salvation by no other name under heaven but through Him. So if you don't know that you would go to heaven today if something happened, and you want Jesus as your Lord and Savior, would you just raise your hand up and say, "Pastor, that's me. I want to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior." Would you do that? Would you raise your hand today? Guys, I'm telling you, the invitation is there. Don't carry your burdens on your own. Yield control of your life. Don't carry them on your own. Let Him. Jesus invites you to the table. And it's at that table you're going to find rest. You're going to find comfort. You're going to find healing. You're going to find restoration. You're going to find peace, hope, direction, and much, much more. Me and Pastor Mark will be up here at the front during our closing song. If you would like somebody to pray with you, we'll be here. We'll be available. Help us with the chairs after it's over. But we'll also be here to pray with you a little longer too. I love you. God bless. Let's close in this song.